अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीवन, डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू स्टैंडर्ड 11th. फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम यू आर बीइंग इंट्रोड्यूस्ड टू द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स एज अ सेपरेट डिसिप्लिन. यू हैव ऑलरेडी बीन फैमिलियराइज्ड विद सम ऑफ द कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स फ्रॉम योर स्टैंडर्ड 5th ऑनवर्ड्स, स्पेशली इन द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी. Now this year you are being introduced to the subject of economics as an independent subject. This will enable you to understand the various economic concepts thoroughly and correlate them with the practical life. The syllabus of standard 11 for economics focuses on realistic approaches to solve real world problem. You will be introduced with various concepts such as money, economic growth, economic development, economic planning, statistics and so on. We will discuss all these topics in detail in the lectures to come. For today, we'll start with the first chapter, that is basic concepts in economics. To begin with, we will study the meaning of economics. Economics is a social science. As you all know, there are two branches of science. One is natural science, another one is social science. Natural science is one whose laws are universally acceptable and their validity can be tested. Natural science includes subjects like mathematics, physics, chemistry, where the laws are known and universally accepted. What is social science? Social science is called abstract or behavioral science because it is related to the study of human behavior. For example, psychology. It is related to mental aspect of human behavior. Sociology is related to the study of social aspect of human behavior. Social science are not universal in nature. They are only statements of general human tendencies. Human nature cannot be tested and it cannot be same across various fields, right? So it is not universally accepted. And therefore, economics is a social science. For different economists, the meaning of economics may be different. It is not a compulsory or universally accepted law. The word economics is derived from the Greek word oikonomia, which means management of the household. So when you are studying how to manage household in terms of money or in terms of needs, then you are studying economics. Another point is, economics is referred to as the queen of social sciences by Paul Samuelson. Economics deals with the economic aspect of human behavior. It deals with how human beings satisfy unlimited wants with limited means. As you all know, there are limited resources available in the world, and how these limited resources are being used by the human being for satisfying their unlimited wants is all you will study in economics. So in simple words, economics is the study of human behavior. It studies how limited resources are being used in order to satisfy unlimited human wants. Now we'll study Kautilya's view on economics. Kautilya was a great philosopher, economist during the Maurya period. he was also known as Chanakya. So according to him, what is economics? He defined economics as Arthashastra. Artha means wealth and Shastra means science. So according to him, economics is the science of wealth. When you are studying the knowledge of wealth, then you are seeking, you are studying or you are understanding the economics. Arthashastra implies the science of acquiring and managing wealth. Arthashastra is a treatise on political economy in its broadest sense. That means when you study how the wealth of a particular nation is being managed, where it is being used, from where it is being sourced, you are studying Arthashastra, that means economics. According to him, the government plays a crucial role in economics. And the focus should be on the creation of wealth as the mean to ensure welfare of the state. That means, according to him, if a society have to progress, then the focus should be on wealth creation, because if people will have wealth, they'll be able to live a better standard of living. He also focused on the need for efficient administrative machinery for good governance. That means not only it is important to create wealth, but it is equally important to manage it. And for managing it, there should be a proper authority, proper government, proper governance that will look after the wealth of the nation. So according to him, economics means Arthashastra, and Arthashastra is nothing but the creation and governance of wealth. Now, as we have discussed earlier, economics is a social science. That means different economists will have different theories of economics. They'll understand economics in different ways. So we'll see some of the definitions given by different economists, the first one being Adam Smith's definition. So according to Adam Smith, economics is based on wealth. So his definition is often regarded as wealth-oriented definition. Adam Smith's wealth-oriented definition of economics. Adam Smith is also regarded as the father of economics. He has given wealth-oriented definition of economics. That means his definition of economics is based on wealth, just like Kautilya. Out of his many books or contribution to the economics, he is the most famous for the book called An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of Wealth of Nations. In that book, Adam Smith defines economics as a science of wealth. According to him, economics is nothing but science of wealth. That means when you study how the wealth is being created, how it is being used and accumulated, and how it is being governed, then you are studying economics. So in order to understand economics properly, it is important to know all the points related to wealth. He focused on certain important points. For example, according to him, non-intervention of the government is important. When economics policies are being formed or implemented, there should be no government control. It should be by the people in general. He also focused on capital and wealth accumulation. According to him, one must not only spend his income or wealth, he should also save it, accumulate it for further investment. And he also focused on division of labor as an aspect of growth theory. That means, if a nation has to progress, if a nation wants to have economic growth or economic development, then there should be proper division of labor. There should be proper employment opportunities available for all the people of the nation. So, according to Adam Smith, there should be creation of wealth. Wealth governance should not be in the hands of government alone. Then another point is, there should be proper employment opportunities, and there should be proper investment of the wealth accumulated. The next definition is given by Professor Alfred Marshall. Professor Alfred Marshall has given the welfare-oriented definition of economics. In his book, Principles of Economics, which was published in the year 1890, Adam Smith has given the definition based on wealth. Professor Alfred Marshall has given the definition based on welfare. Now, according to Alfred Marshall, economics is a study of mankind in the ordinary business of life. It examines that part of individual and social action which is closely connected with the attainment and use of material requisites of well-being. We will break the definition in 4 points. The first one is, it is the study of an ordinary man. That means, in economics, you study the behavior or the well-being or the state of mind of an ordinary man, of people in general. Another important part of the definition is, economics is a behavioral science. That means, you are studying the behavior of the people, which is ever changing. It is not fixed. It is not universal. Different people will behave differently in different situations and conditions. So when you are studying economics, you are studying behavioral science. That means it will be different for different people. Another one, our next point is, study of material welfare. That means economics, when you are studying economics, the focus is on the material welfare of the people. How people are using the resources available in order to progress or in order to improve their standard of living. And it is not simply a study of wealth. That means it is not only important to earn money, it is also important that how that money is being utilized in order to improve the standard of living. According to Adam Smith, economics was only the study of wealth, how the wealth is being generated. But according to Alfred Marshall, economics is not only the study of wealth, but also the study of material welfare of human beings. That means economics also focuses on the welfare of the people, on improving the standard of living of the people. So the key points of Alfred Marshall's definition is that it is the study of behavioral science of human beings, and it is not only wealth oriented but also material welfare oriented. That means wealth is not only important, welfare of human beings is equally important. The third definition is given by Lionel Robbins. This is the most popular definition of economics. Professor Robbins, in his book entitled An Essay on the Nature and Significance of Economic Science, published in the year 1932, mentions about the scarcity-oriented definition of economics. Adam Smith's definition was wealth-oriented. Alfred Marshall's definition was welfare-oriented. And Robbins' definition is scarcity-oriented. So according to Professor Robbins, economics is a science which studies human behavior as a relationship between ends and scarce means which have alternative uses. The key points of Professor Robbins' definitions are that wants are unlimited. Human wants are unlimited. Human beings are ready with another want immediately once the one want is complete. For example, say today you may be in need of a book. Tomorrow you may demand or want another book. And the next day you may also want some pen or pencils. So the human wants are unlimited. Whereas the means are comparatively limited. The resources which are available in the world are limited, are scarce in nature. According to him, wants are gradable on the basis of priority. Since the wants are limited and resources are unlimited, Professor Robbins have suggested that human beings should prioritize their wants. They should give priority to the wants or to the needs which are important and accordingly make use of the resources. According to him, means have alternative uses. So, the resources should be used for alternative purposes. For example, electricity. Electricity can be used for running your electrical appliances. It can also be used for running the vehicles. There are electrical automobiles available. So, limited resources should be used in multiple ways, in alternative ways, so that the wants are satisfied. In simple words, Professor Robbins focused on the fulfillment of human wants, unlimited human wants, through the use of limited resources. He focused on using the resources in a sustainable manner so that the resources are available for future generations as well. So, according to him, economics is not merely the study of welfare generation, or it is not only the study of wealth generation or welfare of the people. It basically means that human wants should be fulfilled in such a manner that the limited resources are being utilized optimally and are available for the generations to come as well. As we have seen the definition of economics, now we'll study the branches of economics. In the year 1933, Professor Ragnar Frisch coined the terms microeconomics and macroeconomics. These are the two branches of economics. Your entire economics can be divided into two parts. The first one is macro and the second one is micro. We'll study each part in detail. We will begin with the first one, that is macroeconomics today. The first branch of economics is macroeconomics. Macro means large or aggregate or total. So when you are studying any concept in total or in aggregate, then you are studying macroeconomics. Macroeconomics is the study of aggregates covering the entire economy, such as total employment, national income, national output, total investment, total savings, total consumption, general price level, and so on. So when I'm studying the national income, what is the income of the nation as a whole? I'm studying macroeconomics. Or when I'm studying what is the employment level in the nation as a whole, then I'm studying macroeconomics. According to Kenneth Boulding, macroeconomics deals not with individual quantities as such, but with the aggregates of these quantities. Not with the individual income, but with the national income. Not with the individual price, but with the general price level. Not with individual output, but with the national output. What you mean by this definition? So according to Kenneth Boulding, macroeconomics deals with aggregate quantities, total quantities, and not individual quantities. So when I'm studying the income of, say, person A, then I'm not studying macroeconomics, I'm studying microeconomics. But when I'm studying the income of the nation, then I'm studying macroeconomics. Another example could be of the output. Say person A is producing 10,000 kgs of rice. Then the output of person A is 10,000 kgs. But this is not the output of the entire nation. Throughout the nation, the production of rice could be, say, 10 lakh kgs. Then this 10 lakh kgs will be part of macroeconomics because it is the output of the nation. It is the total output. So when you study any concept in aggregate or in terms of its total form, then you are studying macroeconomics. Basic concepts of macroeconomics. There are certain terms or concepts which are very commonly used in macroeconomics. The first one is national income. National income reveals the total economic performance of a nation. It is referred to as the total income of a country. In simple terms, it is the monetary value of all the goods and services produced in an economy during a year. So, for example, if I am saying there are 10,000 kgs of rice being produced in the nation. So, we will take out the monetary value of this 10,000 kgs of rice, and that will be your national income. All the goods and services which are being produced in the country or which are being provided in the country will be converted in terms of money, and that value will be considered as national income. National income is an important part of macroeconomics or important concept of macroeconomics. another concept of macroeconomics is savings. It is that part of the income which is set aside to satisfy the future needs by foregoing the current consumption. Savings is that part of income which is not spent currently on consumption. Suppose you have an income of say 1 lakh rupees for a year and you have spent 90,000 of it on your daily needs, on your foods, clothing and so on. The 10,000 which you have not spent will be your savings. This savings you may use for your future needs. Say if there is any medical emergency, you may use that savings, or you can use that savings for your further education and so on. So savings is an important part of income, and it is also a very relevant concept of macroeconomics. Obviously, you will not study the savings of individual person in macroeconomics. You will study the savings at national level. What is the savings of, say, the country like India? How much it earns, how much it is spending, and what is the savings for future investment? So that will be part of macroeconomics. Investment. Investment refers to the creation of capital assets through mobilization of savings. For example, there's a businessman. He earns a certain amount of profit. Out of that profit, he sets aside a certain amount for further investment. So suppose his profit is rupees 1 lakh. Out of that 1 lakh, he's spending 50,000 on his needs. The remaining 50,000 he is investing in the business again. This rupees 50,000 will be termed as investment. He could buy a new machinery, or he can buy a new equipment, or he can undertake a construction of a factory and so on. So when a person invests a certain amount in his business for further growth and development, it is called as investment, and it is an important part of macroeconomics. In macroeconomics, obviously, you will study the investment made by the government at national level. How much amount of the government spending, or how much amount of the savings of the government are being invested for the growth and development of the nation. When you study the investment of government, you are studying macroeconomics. Trade cycles. Trade cycles are fluctuations in business. They are the ups and downs in the overall economic activities. These ups and downs are caused by inflation and depression in the economy. Inflation is a continuous rise in the general price level. That means, say for example, rupees 10 in the earlier years had more value as compared to today's economic scenario. You can take the example of, say, vada pav. Earlier, vada pav used to come for 2 rupees. But now, the price of vada pav have increased to rupees 10. So there is increase in the value of goods and services and reduction in the value of money. Earlier, 10 rupees could fetch 5 vada pavs, but today 10 rupees will fetch only 1 vada pav. Depression. Depression is a continuous fall in overall prices and lowering down of economic activity. When there is depression in the economy, the businesses often face a lot of loss, and as a result, the business activities get slowed down, which impacts the overall growth of the nation. So these trade cycles are an important part of the study of macroeconomics. The next concept in macroeconomics is economic growth and economic development. These two concepts are very much important for economics. What is economic growth? Economic growth means an increase in the real national income of the country. That means when the value of goods and services in the country increases, there is economic growth. Now, what is economic development? Economic development indicates economic growth plus progressive changes in certain important variables which determine the well-being of the people. That means, in order for the economy to develop, it is not only important to increase the value of goods and services, the welfare of the people is also important. So when there is increase in the value of goods and services plus there is improved standard of living of the people, then there will be economic development. Economic growth is a narrow concept and quantitative concept. It focuses on the quantity of goods and services, whereas economic development is a broader concept and it is a qualitative concept. Economic development focuses on the quality of the lives of the people. It focuses on improving the quality of standard of living of the people. Economic growth is possible without economic development. However, economic development is not possible without economic growth. Economic growth is a unidimensional concept. That means there is only one dimension, one aspect to it, that is the increase in the value of goods and services. Whereas economic development is a multi-dimensional concept. It focuses on the increase in the value of goods and services. It also focuses on the welfare of the people. It focuses on improving the standard of living of the people. So it is multi-dimensional. Economic growth is a spontaneous and reversible concept. That means in 1 year there could be an increase in the value of goods and services, whereas say in another year there could be decrease in the value of goods and services. So the concept of economic growth is reversible. It can change, it can be reversed. Whereas economic development is deliberate and irreversible. That means if the standard of living of the people is being improved, then you cannot get those people back to, say, lower standard of living. It is a deliberate concept. People make conscious effort to improve their standard of living. So, it is deliberate and irreversible. Economic growth is measured in terms of national income and per capita income. We have already seen it is a quantitative concept. In economic growth, you study what is the value of goods and services in the nation, that is national income. You also study what is individual income, how much per person is earning, and that is the indicator of economic growth. Whereas on the other hand, economic development is measured in terms of agricultural productivity. industrial productivity, quality of human life, and so on. That means it focuses on improvement in the activities that takes place in the nation. It focuses on improving the quality of human life. So when the standard of living of the people of the nation is improving, it is an indicator of economic development. So this is the distinguish or point of difference between economic growth and economic development. These two concepts are very much important for macroeconomics and for economics in general. So today we have seen the meaning of economics, we have seen different definitions, and one of the branches of economics, that is, we have seen the macroeconomics part. We will study the microeconomics in next lecture. That's all for today. Thank you.